If you haven't had a chance to read the minutes, please do that, and I would entertain a motion.
For what?
After we read it.
I already read it. I think Brenda said it should be copied.
He reads his own mind.
Right.
Yeah.
Motion, Lieber?
I move to accept the minutes as written.
Second. Any additions, corrections? All those in favor? Leslie, I think you're voting, I think, tonight, if I'm correct. And Gavin's not here, so. Okay, old business. Looks like the zoning paper that you may have in your booklet, if you haven't spotted it yet, is up first. And if you look at it for a second, you'll begin to realize, I think, that the upper part, the expansion in the shoreline district, and the lower part, the expansion in the resource protection district, are essentially going to be the same things. We're just separating them. And then when you get to the lower part, you're going to note at some point that B says after September 29th, which was the date that the ordinance came into effect in 2011. And then, as I understand it, any mention of water bodies that may have been in the upper part, the shoreland, has been taken out of the second part where it says resource protection. And another little clerical change has been that if you were to look in the manual, on page 4, it says 1.4.11.1 as maintenance or enlargement. And in reality, that's not anything other than, can't usually say the word definition, but a description. So essentially what we've done is taken that number away from that, just included that little paragraph up above with non-conforming buildings, and then used that number in what we have been doing with the expansion in the Shoreland District. And then point 2 becomes expansion in the resource protection. Not that that necessarily is clear. Because I'm saying it and I'm not sure it's clear.
But otherwise there it goes to point 12. We would have to change the other 10. Mm-hmm.
So when we get to the public hearing, assuming we agree, all agree on it, when we get to the public hearing, we'll just make it clear to everybody who's here where we put that existing paragraph, and then why we are making the new numbers the way they are. I'm not sure whether or not, you know, you guys can decide whether we ourselves just can make this decision tonight and say, okay, this is the way we want it, or is it worth taking it home and then taking a good look at reading it, at a time when you are comfortable looking at all the words and things like that, and then come back next week or next time we have a meeting and vote for it or against it.
That works for me, because I mean there's quite a bit of verbiage there, even though it's redundant from the in the shoreline language, and then we can.
And if there is something that's missing, or if there is something that, you know, we can, you know, maybe pick up on it or don't see something. So, I mean, in my mind, if everybody's in agreement with that, then that works for me.
I think that's a good idea.
Okay. All right. Great. So that's homework for next time. Unless there's questions this time. I mean, I don't want to throw it out. I know you're looking at it. Maybe something's popping into your head, too.
Just to kind of start to wrap my brain around this a little bit. So before September 29, 2011, structures within resource protection outside of shoreland...
Did not exist. Yep.
Okay.
So that's... at that time is when the town of Acton expanded shoreland zoning outside of the... expanded resource protection outside of the shoreland zone, became more stringent than the state.
But, excuse me, Ken, there were quite a number of structures that existed in the resource protection district prior to 9/29/11.
In the shoreland zone.
And not out of the shoreland zone?
No, I don't think so. I think it was all resource protection shoreland zone. So it was all under the state guidelines, which is the heading on that, the current point one.
Yeah.
So that was the resource protection within the shoreland zone. So
So what you were saying, I think, is that what we refer to as shoreland and RP now, at one time was all shoreland? Is that what we're saying?
No, there was RP in the shoreland zone, but it was greater than 10 acres of wetlands. So when Acton adopted theirs, it started at 2 acres of forested wetlands, so you could just have hydric soil, and that had a sliding buffer that started at 50 feet. And all of a sudden, we started with these resource protections outside of the shoreland zone. So, and you could call it state jurisdiction or town jurisdiction, if it made it any more clearer. So this had a lot more houses, subdivisions we've recently approved, and now all of a sudden they're in resource protection and things like that. So it expanded more all over. And when the state's resource protection came in, there was no more building in there at all. So there was that time from the late 80s to 20, 30 years roughly of building, and then more resource protection came in on that. And those are the areas that are in the resource protection outside of the shoreline zone.
You think this, then, your proposal here gives some equivalency then to the way we had been treating it previously in the shoreline zone for those areas now that we're proposing to provide the same 30% expansion for those
in the best practical locations? Yeah. A lot of times mortgage companies or insurance companies are looking for a letter from us that says, from the underwriters, if this house burns down, they can replace it. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a standard letter. So in this aspect, we'll usually walk them through, yes, you can replace it. May not be in that same spot. If it's non-conforming, it's going to be relocated, mm-hmm. unless it's historical. And you may need to new septic system and a few other things. That's the only exemption there.
Yeah.
So, but that makes the insurance company's underwriters more relaxed, that they know that their policy, that they're not going to lose out.
Yeah.
Okay, any other comments, questions? All right, then we'll deal with this next time. How about the timber harvesting? Any news on setting up that workshop?
Steve's got quite a few projects going right now, and we're just getting caught up with our stuff, so we're hoping after Thanksgiving to sit down and really take a look at how much redundancy is in there, how much we want to eliminate or add. Mm-hmm. I think talking with him, eliminate a lot of the confusion, the option two and yep. the option one, if the town's on their own or the town's going to work with the state. So
a quick question on that. Basically, the state's ordinances or regulations are similar to what we have. Are they more strict or are we more strict?
On the second question or the first question?
On the first question, we'll reword this. The timberland, the timberland harvesting, is the state rules and regulations the same as ours, stricter than ours, or less than ours?
Less words than ours.
Well, so I think that's a good thing. The less you've got to read, the better it is.
I think so too, because you have less interpretations.
Less confusion.
May, shall, and, or, a lot of that makes a huge difference. So,
can't use the word may. The word may is optional. You've got to use the word shall.
Exactly.
I had to write the procedures for ISO.
So I think working with the forest is going to be good to help us clean that up so it's much easier to enforce. And the end result is a harvest that doesn't have erosion control issues. You know, stabilized harvest, and technology's come a long ways too.
Well, the only thing I was asking for is because I know people that live here in town that are my age or older, which is possible, and be older.
Yeah.
They depend on some of the harvesting to pay their taxes because they're on a fixed income. And they've been doing it for years, and for us to step in all of a sudden tomorrow morning and say, oh no, you can't do this anymore. We've got to take a look at the financial impact that's going to have on a family that's depending on it. Mm-hmm. Now, we've already outlawed all the paper mills, and we're doing a good job of driving the rest of the business out of the country. So, we're just concerned about the income of people who depend on those harvestings.
Yeah.
Tom, you have a question?
I'm just curious if from a more recent letter from the Forest Service turned up, because Stephen alluded to one with a more recent date on it than the one you shared with us a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, it doesn't sound familiar. Did he get it from us or straight from the state to him?
I thought he was mentioning it was just to the state, from the state, and that it corroborated our sense that there had been, initially they said you're out to lunch, you have to revamp some stuff, and then this other letter that he said came in to him corroborated the fact that they had reviewed it and we were okay with option two as it stands. So, I don't know. I'll have to...
Unless it went to the selectmen, but they usually share.
Yeah. I'll try to get that so he communicates that.
Yeah, he had just called a minute ago, right when we started the meeting, so once he gets his stuff and I can get together, and probably right after Thanksgiving.
Next part is the zoning ordinance for the solar wind turbines. And I know we're still looking for something from
Southern Maine Regional.
Southern Maine Regional. Maybe that was what we found.
We've seen a few different ordinances out there. I'm surprised there's not more to pick from. I think Falmouth, we picked up one or two, and down with Yarmouth or something like that. But there's not a lot of good out there. We'll try Southern Maine too and get them on board.
All right.
I was talking to my nephew who was building these turbines. And I've been near some of them myself personally and heard the noise. These are the biggest problem they were having in being close to a town. I don't know where he's out in New Mexico. When they were close to a town, noise became an issue. And the way they got around it, the town did, is by the height measurement. No structure to be more than so many feet high, except for cell towers, or radio towers, the communication towers. So by just holding that part of their funding system, they were able to stop them. Mm-hmm. Because it would cost too much money to fight in the court. Because they have to be like 80 feet high. Yeah. Some of them even more, 120 feet. Some of the blades are 60 feet long. So he was saying that was one of the biggest things that they come across was that could stop them. Was the height.
Mm-hmm. Like I said, my concern from the get-go has been to make sure that if they are going to be allowed, regardless of whether it's the solar or the turbines, that we can decide where, you know, as opposed to letting somebody come along and say, oh, I'm going to put it here, kind of a deal. So all right, we'll move on with that.
Similar to the other one as far as blocking, like, the neighbor's view?
Yeah, that could be part of it. That could be part of it.
So you wouldn't be able to block it with a solar tower, but you could build a shed and block their view.
Maybe a shed is not going to, you know, maybe there's controls on the size of the shed you could do.
So the one that I'm thinking of is
pretty large.
Oh, it's hideous.
You know, so I mean, I think of it as being larger than a shed.
Mm-hmm. As far as that, but I mean, if we're looking at regulation, and the main thing is to, or one of the objectives is that it's not put in somebody's way that can view the lake or the mountains and the neighbor throws it up, we would still have the problem if the neighbor threw up a shed with no solar or anything like that, or somebody comes along and builds a house there.
Oh yeah, sure.
You know,
sure.
That's something we run into all the time, but right. It comes back to you should have bought the lot to secure your view.
Yeah. But to me, that between houses, even if there was no view of the lake, is not necessarily pleasant. But again, that could be just my opinion. You know, I don't know.
And like you were saying with the wind turbine, especially the big one, the noise is
noise is unbelievable. It's annoying type noise. You get like a whishing noise, and then all of a sudden the props change because the wind changes, and you get a different type of noise.
Yeah.
It drives you crazy. But in case it even... Once you live with them, I'm just repeating now what I've heard the noise. I'm repeating what my nephew from Aaron does. He said that one thing after a while you get used to is like when I lived down on the river, for the first few months the waterfalls kept me awake. And after a while you get adjusted. But like if you live in the city, the buses and streetcars. But he said, but until you get used to it. And then you finally get used to it, all of a sudden the wind changes and now you get another problem.
Okay, how about next? Do Do we deal with anything dealing with Pepin at all tonight?
No, I know they're doing research. It looked like he had a gathering going out there today. I'm not sure who he had going out there with him, but I think my biggest question, and I had mentioned that early on with the meetings with him, is the ordinance does allow a gravel pit in resource protection shoreline zone, maybe not the philosophy, of less than 10,000 yards per year. How are you going to cut the trees in that area? You're allowed to remove up to 40%, no clear openings greater than 10,000 square feet, so it's a quarter acre. Most gravel pits, they've cleared the trees all right out, so in this aspect, maybe it's, and that's something they've got to figure out, is if they're doing their 10,000 acres, or 10,000 yards, how are they having a timber, a clear open big enough to do a gravel pit? That was my bigger question for him.
Didn't he address that at the last meeting, saying he'd be replanting?
That was my suggestion, as they went, but still, your clear openings could only be so big.
There's one thing I'd like to bring out, excuse me, but Tommy, you just got to talk.
Well, I was under the impression that we were at least going to make a determination on the Bergen Parkinson letter tonight. As to what
you still have an application?
No. No, he's still in pre, just talking. So I haven't gotten our attorney involved with it yet to take a look at it until you guys give me the go-ahead. My initial thought, and I was kind of going with what Gavin was thinking, is 10,000 per lot, not 10,000 in the shoreland, 10,000 in resource protection, 10,000 in Little Ospey. I'm okay, and I'd have to read the definition a little bit more, that they have a conditional use to pull unlimited out in the critical rural and 10,000 in the others, but I think it's really stretching it to grab 10 out of the other three zones as well.
And I guess the reference to the 20,000 in the letter is her, I believe, her saying that there could be two places where she could pull, wants to pull 10 each, as opposed to what I thought I had heard early on, that they wanted at least three more places that they wanted to pull 10,000 each of. So it seems like they've come back to just two that they're looking for, if I'm reading it correctly. Because she does mention 20,000.
Yeah.
In there.
If anybody has taken a ride over and see their pit, that's, I couldn't go for the walk with you guys, but I could ride right by it. It's right through the edge of the road on Old Mill Road. You see the pit that used to be an Agway store there. It's an abandoned house.
That's our Agway pit, yeah.
That pit there is an eyesore and a half. Mm. And I believe that's what Pepin's home out there, too, aren't they?
I think that is the pit, yeah.
But this is not in an area that you're going to have many cars driving by.
No, the thing I'm concerned about is they're taking all that, those resources out of that area in the town that they do business in. We get peanuts for taxes out of this. It's not like harvesting timber where the state at least gets something. We don't get one red dime. And we're going to let them do what they want, and they say, well, the big giveaway here is, well, we're going to give this land to the trust fund. Now we don't get taxes neither. So we get absolutely nothing out of this except getting the living hell beat out of the roads. Like he said about the situation of the wheat. I talked to my brother once, I was now visiting with him and his wife, and she's in rehab, and he owns those trucks. And the biggest damage is done when the truck is empty. When they go over the road and the constant bang, 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 bang. That's what does the damage. It's nothing to do with wheat.
I mean, as far as the taxes are concerned, I think you brought up the fact that they were paying minimal taxes now.
$2,000 a year.
Right. So, I mean, the difference between getting $2,000 and getting nothing is not significant.
No, but the thing is that we're getting nothing, zero out of this situation, and it all goes to taxes, and their tax base is all in Sanford. Let them go to Sanford. Why have to tear up the zones that are questionable? For $10,000 a year, $10,000 a year, go spend your money someplace else. Get the whole damn thing to conservation. You know, just to irritate you, think that they're going to tear everything out of my town, and we get nothing. We're not even, people get employed by them.
Any other comments?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was under the impression that we were going to discuss this a little bit tonight, and I was hopeful, as I've expressed at previous meeting, that we would make a determination. So when I don't really know if we're helping or hurting the Pepins by not making a determination, but it would seem as if you're putting down a decision that enables the process to go forward based upon that decision, whether it be yes or no. But at least we had some material put in front of us, and I thought if we all have had some time to look that over, it might be a wise use of our time tonight to come to grips with that. I'm speaking of the Bergen Parkinson.
Yeah. If we were to make a decision, Ken, on this, would you be comfortable going forward if we made the decision that we wanted to see one the attorney to look at this for us? Would you be okay with talking to the selectman upstairs to see if that's a possibility?
It's your line, your expenditures for the attorney, but I would double check with them, you know, to, before we spent it, got an opinion on it. But again, we don't even have an application pending in front of us. I'd usually wait for the application, that way there we know they're serious, they're moving forward, they haven't, you know, they've looked at all their options and this is going to work for them, or I know, you know, we've gone out for a site walk and such, but I mean, it's you guys' call, whatever you want to do.
Well, I mean, you know, I guess I made the assumption that with everything that we got last week, that the application was coming, you know, quickly. I didn't realize that you still haven't had it 2 weeks later.
Mm-hmm. I think we resent him at the beginning of this week.
Mm-hmm. Didn't he say he got to wait for a little osity?
Soccer River Carter Commission?
Soccer River Carter Commission, right.
That's a second review process. It'd be similar to waiting for the state. So if we did go through the process and review it with our conditions, that could be a condition on it that they obtain soccer.
Well, I thought he was waiting to get some of that before he finalized some of the paperwork that's going to bring to us. That's the way I interpreted it when you see it.
See, I interpreted that they weren't going to make a decision.
No, he was going to wait to hear from him before he made a decision.
No, I don't mean him. I mean Soccer River wasn't going to make a decision until we made a determination.
I just feel we're not really doing anyone any favors, ourselves included, if we let more and more information come in on this thing pertaining to the legal complexity of it, or lack thereof, before we make our decision. We have a legal opinion in front of us, and I think we have the wisdom to give it an opinion, whether or not that would indicate to them that they maybe have to reconsider, or it would warrant the expenditure of our monies for our town lawyer. I don't know, because I think the Pepins would have to take some action to trigger the expenditure of funds, you know, responsibly on our part. Why do we have to hire a lawyer to defend a decision that we've made before it's challenged by Pepin? Doesn't make sense, I don't think.
Well, do we know where we legally stand after reading a letter that an attorney has developed?
Their attorney.
Yeah, their attorney.
When I went through this, my method of trying to get my arms around this was initially to go back into the zoning ordinance, because that's what Ms. Rachin had to do with her work. She was not, you know, pulling these things out of the air. She went into the zoning ordinance and saw how the Pepin project lined up with that, and made some inferences, and this is what she's come up with. I tried to do the same thing, and I didn't end up in the same spot she did, but I thought it would be useful to discuss it if we all had a chance to look at it between the last meeting and now.
Well, why don't we take a little bit of time then, and we'll look at it. do you want to point out where you see differences from what she is saying?
Unless someone else wants to... Anybody decide to speak? In general, I would start maybe on page 2. And I need Ken's help with a map on this. Ken, can you bring up a map on a computer?
Yeah.
If he needs a copy, I've got it.
We could do it just from looking at the small map in our zoning one as well. Ms. Rachin, on the first paragraph of page 2, claims that there was a tremendous diminution of the property's value because the ordinance as amended from 2008 to 9/29/11. That's the maps that are in the front of here, the zoning one that's spoke there. And the one we want to look at is map 202, which was adopted in at a town meeting in 2011. What I discovered today was, in light of her claim, was that all of the RP lands as designated in the, what would be the northeast corner of the map 202, which comprises all of the wetlands and their surrounding buffer on Mr. Pepin's land, are over 10 acres. I.e., they had a buffer of 250 feet previous to September 29, 2011, and they had a buffer unchanged afterwards because we did not meddle with the state standard. Mm-hmm. So her claim that there was a great effect of the amendments, I don't think holds any water whatsoever.
They can't be applying for the permit the way they are.
That's what I'm leading up to.
Yeah. I mean, it's dead in the water. And our interpretation.
Well, I want to go through and make a few more points, but on this particular point, I'm a little confused about this first substantive claim that she makes. And I don't know quite. I was trying to put myself in her mode of thinking, and I couldn't get my arms around what she was trying to give any legitimacy to the claim. Can we put map 202, Ken, on the wall? That would show Mr. Pepin's lawn. Should I keep going? Can you show map 202 as it's illustrated in the book, which is a more simplified version of what you have? Just showing the straight 250 buffers around all of the wetlands that are in excess of 10 acres. What I think was a little confusing was when Matt was showing us the map, and he was detailing different acreages of resource protection buffers that they wanted to mine in, we were led astray from the fact that the buffer was, in all cases, surrounding a 10-acre or greater. It's probably a 20-acre wetland.
Which one? This one here? Or this one up here?
All of them. All of the ones where they had, and we could look at them, map that he brought up last week to make it more clear. So my thought was that there was no basis to the claim that there was a great loss in the property's value, because essentially there was no change in the IP designation. The second point, I did not understand on page 3 where Ms. Rachin starts to talk about, she was trying to make a comparison with things that are not comparable in terms of residential dwelling units and units, building units in general, and how there can be different uses on the same site. That has essentially no pertinence to what we're dealing with.
Right, she was talking about structures as opposed to talking about uses, which is not included in there, even though she threw the word in there.
Right, yeah, it is existent in the second usage of it.
But I think it's more use.
Well, anyway, that was a fallacy, because she's comparing apples to oranges. We're dealing here with a mineral extraction permit out of a strip mall. The other thing that stuck in my mind was the reference. I looked through definitions, land use charts, and I think the strongest suit for us is still on page 45 in the old Orange Book. And it's under Mineral Extractive Industry 592B1. And this is what Gavin pointed out to us a number of weeks ago when we were discussing this. This is written, expressed in a kind of a backward way, but I'll try to read it so that it's more sensible. It reads, except in the shoreland, these are exceptions to the rule not requiring a conditional use permit. Number one reads, except in the shoreland district and the resource protection district, the removal or transfer of less than 10,000 yards of material from or onto any lot in any 12-month period. The way you could read that in a positive sense is that those lots in the shoreland district and RP district, or those areas on a lot in the shoreland district and resource protection district, gravel is permitted to be removed or transferred in amounts of less than 10,000 cubic yards pertaining to that lot. In other words, there can be one extraction of 10,000 cubic yards, or less than 10,000 cubic yards, with a CUP, a permit, conditional use permit, in the shoreland district and resource protection district. Over 10,000 yards, those uses are not permitted.
So is that saying that the shoreland and the resource protection could have 10,000 taken out if they did get a conditional use permit, or is it saying that it can't be done?
No, it's saying it could be done with a conditional use permit, but it would have to be less than 10,000 yards.
On,
yeah. But the key phrase is there.
Any lot.
My mind is any lot.
Yeah, that's right. What I was on from day one. Is, you know, that's all we've always looked at it, is 10,000 per lot.
And I think the proof of that comes from the thought that, and this is where I disagree strongly with the contention of Ms. Rachin, to accept their understanding of this is to totally subvert the entire objective of having, as we do have existent, a distinction between the removal of less than or greater than 10,000 yards per year. If we were to go along with her thinking on this, Mr. Pepin could remove from three or four spots on that lot in amounts of less than 10,000 yards within a year. But that flies in the face of the distinction that we have in the ordinance of the citation that demands for a different set of rules if you're removing over 10,000 yards. It's just an end run around that ordinance, which on the face of it, doesn't hold, it doesn't pass the straight face test.
Tom, I took a look when I first got into this, and I don't have it, I was looking for it, couldn't find it. But I think in the tax rules, it's more than one lot. I mean, that big piece is divided up into three pieces. So I don't know what that means, it's three separate lots?
Kenny would have to address that one. I think on the, he gets one tax bill.
Yes, but it refers to three pieces. I think it's either two or three pieces.
The lot? They have one lot. They do have a little tiny one across the street.
Oh, okay, maybe that's what the difference was I saw in the tax bill. Okay.
I keep getting hung up on the word except, going back to B1.
So that's saying you don't need a conditional use to take out 10,000 yards at your house. These were for people that had excavation businesses and could dig some dirt out behind their house.
Yep.
So that says you can dig 10,000 yards a year from behind your house, but not in the shoreline zone and the resource protection.
Okay.
So that's saying
that you do need a conditional use permit, even if you are taking less than 10,000, if you're in resource protection?
That's because if we go to the land use chart, the chart's going to say it's allowed in shoreland resource protection and Little Ospie with a conditional use.
Okay.
So we go back to the one you were looking at where it says except, and I think the biggest thing I looked at that is per lot or a lot.
Any lot.
Any lot.
Yeah.
And the intention there was, and it's not saying if you have a conditional use in the shoreland zone, Little Ospie, and this, it's per lot. It doesn't say it clearly like that. Again, more words get you in trouble.
Yeah, it does.
It does.
The more complicated you make it, the harder it is for someone to interpret it.
Yeah.
A lot of words in this letter.
Yeah. 12 pages.
You know, by looking at which, I haven't got my book in front, I wasn't looking here, but I think I got it in my car. But if this is per lot, it's a state, and that's the way I'm reading it, or listening to what you're saying, is the way I interpret it, then they're dead in the water.
Well, oh, they're 10,000 yards per lot.
Yeah. They can't take those, they can't extend up into that upper region.
But the harder thing, I still think the harder thing is they can't cut enough trees to get the 10,000 yards.
Well, I don't like the road, and I haven't seen it except by an aerial thing on the maps. Mm-hmm. And for what they talk about, that road can't be too secure to go out of building that damn road before you can take some heavy dump trucks down from there.
Well, we talked about that the first time he came in, about how he was going to be able to fix that road in order to get this stuff out.
Yeah, it's going to take quite a bit of fixing. Especially in the spring of the year.
You have anything else specific?
No. I'm sorry if I got a little gobbled there.
No, not at all. All right, so we still have to wait on an application, I believe. I mean, I certainly can see Tom's points, but I'm still...
But that was the same point I made with him a couple of months ago when they came in.
I guess, you know, it gets fuzzy. Maybe it gets fuzzy to Matt too, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I genuinely feel upset that these fellows are you know, spending good money after bad, so to speak, trying to keep this thing afloat when maybe the wiser course would have been to get our opinion and then give that to their attorney and have them pick it apart.
They got my opinion, which is the same as yours, months ago, and that's what the attorney kind of picked apart.
Okay.
The board hasn't made a decision yet, because really there's not an application to review it and things like that. I mean, we did go out and do the site walk, so we knew what we were talking about, to beat time change and things like that. But that was kind of before I really thought they were trying to do three areas of 10,000 yards, or two were.
I just feel uncomfortable that if we don't make some kind of decision on this thing soon, we could be accused of kind of dragging our feet or something, but it seems that it's a proper time to render some kind of a vote in the light of what Ms. Rachin has sent across to us, whether we agree with that or disagree.
I mean, in my mind, I can't see how they can say that we aren't moving along, because we don't have that application to push us to get going on it. I mean, it's all hearsay, and it's all, you know, discussion and things like that, but you know, I still have a hard time going too far until I see the application or know that it's in hand.
But, well, my point is, I would like to not see him spend any more money based on the acceptance of this, unconditioned by our thoughts on it. I just don't think it's in a sense, fair to the applicant to not put some thinking in the hopper, so to speak.
He's not an applicant yet.
Well, that's true.
Yeah, but you call him a taxpayer.
So why do you suppose he has not come forward with an application?
He's not sure he can.
Well, I mean, let's see what he's going to come forward looking for. I mean, one thing to be talking and one thing to be writing. And let's just see what he comes forward with. I mean, it all seems to have been changed already from taking 10,000 out of three places to being down now to 10,000 out of two places. Again, if I'm reading it correctly, you know, and maybe somewhere along the line we'll see the light and his application will be down to
one.
You know what? Who knows? All right, unless there's any other comments, let's move along.
Good idea.
We are in, let me get the right one here. Best practical location again. So we got it. Amazing. Somebody must have knocked that out.
No.
A tin soil like a real man.
Remind us where 10th Street is, Ken.
Right after 11th.
Oh, good.
By East Shore Drive, and by 12th. I'll be back out a little bit.
Start up 109.
There's the fairgrounds.
By the Moonscape.
Outside the shoreline zone. We are going to 21.
Lot 21.
There's lot 21.
You own both sides of the street?
You own both sides of the street.
So it's 10th Street. 10th Street and 11th Street, they don't meet?
No. Doesn't like the library Wi-Fi.
Is that what you're on?
I think so, yeah.
Well, they can't get too much closer to the water, could they?
That is the existing place. Behind the camp, it's fairly steep coming right out from behind there. The pitches don't do it much justice.
And is there a level spot up above?
So this is 10th Street, dies out, goes into 11th Street on the other spot. The driveway comes down through. This is the existing house right there. The proposed is in red. So existing 62 feet from the water, 61 feet. 60 feet. So by rotating it, pushing it back, this is the steep slopes as you keep going up there. So by bringing this back into this hill here, It'll at least be an 8-foot foundation, 8 to 9 feet that they're digging into that in the ground, so it could be a little out of it, maybe a 10-foot wall or so into that corner. It changes our low point of 60 feet to 90 feet there, 75 feet here, 62 to 75 there. New septic pump coming back up through there. This is the 100-foot line right there, and the 50-foot line from the road right there. There was a couple more feet we were looking to maybe get it back, but that would go from a 10-foot wall to a 12-foot wall with the foundation that goes into engineering, and we've usually just used the 10-foot wall as a cutoff, basically.
What's the square in the back?
Garage.
Well, that's going into the hill pretty good too, then.
That is just a little tiny bit of the hill right there, and at first I was thinking sliding it over further this way, but that is their access coming down and around right there. Mm-hmm.
That house is 60 feet away from the water?
It doesn't look it, does it? No. It's right on the water.
No.
So that's standing at the house. That's actually a retaining wall right there. Tide's gone out a little bit on this photo.
And the other side of the road?
Oh, there it is.
So that's it's a natural flat spot. That's usually where they build the houses and stuff. Yeah. And they realize by pushing this back as far as they can, this flat spot now becomes a place they can sit and enjoy. And sure. That's usually the toughest thing to get to people, that you need to convince them to, if you move back, you end up with a beautiful lakeside front yard that at this time they really don't have.
So back to the picture again, there, or the map. Where's the well and where's the septic?
I would imagine they'll be putting a new well in on the lakeside.
Uh-huh.
And the septic's going to be up in the road here.
So that road really is just a right-of-way?
Yeah, at this point here, it's really, it dies out right through here, and you can't go through it, drops right off.
Mm-hmm.
These are 20-foot contour lines here, so this is 500, drops down to 480 there, so it's a 20-foot drop there. This is where the house is now, so by relocating it, they were sliding over and into this area here. Septic comes into this area here. This area becomes basically the area that they can call their new front yard.
So what's the existing house size?
Within 100 feet from the water, 1,248 square feet. The proposal would be 822 within the 100 feet. Mm-hmm. The rest is all coming outside of that.
Mm-hmm.
4-bedroom septic design.
So the slope makes it impractical to move it back in, essentially.
Without getting into an engineered design, going to a huge foundation and stuff like that, and you're not going to gain very much more. Because really, I mean, this is the distance between the 50-foot setback and that. Because the intent of the state law, the first thing we do is do a cutout of this house here on a sticky note and try to relocate that. So if it's a 20 by 20 house, we try to relocate a 20 by 20, and if you can do additions off it, it's a good day. We don't look at, you have a 20 by 20 house, but you're trying to build a 60 by 8. In this case, that garage kind of just hung right out, like that was the reason we couldn't go back any further. But in reality, it's the steep slope right in this area here. is why we couldn't go back any further. And at this point, they were almost achieving the 100 feet from here. And, I mean, it's 75 from here. It's still fairly good distance.
Yeah, it's weird, though. It's 90 feet, but at some point, it's like a drop-off. You know, so you got a little bit of level.
Yeah.
Nowhere near the 90 feet that we're talking about, or even a gradual. It's just kind of, okay, level, then it goes like yeah. this.
And then
once everything gets
out.
Over that... It's yeah. heading for the lake.
Yeah.
And they're in agreement with all the conditions that we normally would put in?
Yep, the builders used to working it down and they know stormwater mitigation plans and...
Where are the side setbacks on there?
They had them all on the plans. I told them to get rid of them because there was so much. 60 feet on one, 82 on the other. 66, 82. And the new one actually would be better than what's there because of the how the house is turned. Mm-hmm. We've never done that to people before, and technically by state law, really it's two separate lots, even though they do own it. We've never pushed them behind the road or behind power lines and things like that.
Any other questions, comments? Motion out there, possibly?
I have a movie. Can you make a movie?
Second? Okay. Any other comments about it before we vote?
We'll put the verbiage in the minutes of how many feet it is proposed.
And all the... Any other conditions? Everybody okay with, you know, the...
Revegetation, stormwater mitigation.
Yeah. No?
Just one other question. With the side setbacks, is there any room to move it to the left a little and back?
As far as this being the left?
No, the other left.
This one? I can only get two. So this is all the steep slopes area. So if we bring it over to this way, any?
No, the other way.
The other left?
Yeah.
The first That drops right off into this area here. That's why the road doesn't go through. When you're standing right there, the road just disappears till it comes out to the other side.
And that's where that contour.
Yeah, right there. You see that contour rolls right there. So that's a huge hole right in this whole area here. And the natural driveway came down through this way. So this is a steep slope up in this area. So if we moved it to where the driveway was, then we'd have to blow a hole through this side here. It seemed like a reasonable plan.
Okay. All right, any other questions, concerns? All right, all in favor of the motion then? All opposed? All right, looks like a 5-0. Okay, we have another one.
So we'll go from 10th Street to 12th.
We've been there.
That's right after 11.
It's right in between. 11's right in between the two.
Before 13.
Thank you, Walter.
So originally when this subdivision came in, there was a shared driveway here that came up and went across.
Because
of water in the road. So they put a driveway here, and I mentioned to them that that's not as per plan. So they've gone and had an engineer redo the plan and do calculations and has sent us a letter that says it's no worse than it was proposed.
Yeah, we did that because of the concerns that people had of that road. I'm having a hard time thinking about making a change.
So now he's got two driveway runoffs. Let me tell us what's going to happen in that. He had a swale between the road and the
down through here?
I thought.
Yeah.
That's what I recollect. But
yeah,
and there was a diversion.
Even a little further along.
There was a diversion before it went down 12th Street.
in the woods or something.
Yeah, he's got on the plan a riprap check dam area, and this way, the swale all the way up and down this side.
Does he have a drywall or something in the system there?
That's the drainage easement.
Asking for forgiveness here?
Did he take as many trees as that aerial indicates? I remember that was nicely wooded with mature pines and oaks.
Well, the oaks won't show up in this.
Yeah. This is a wintertime image anyway, it looks like. There's some snow on some of these roofs there.
Have you heard anything about 2-1?
It still looks like it's green there.
Yeah.
So it's 12. Let's go back 4 years.
So I can distinctly remember one of the abutters being there when we went to...
Sidewalk?
Yeah, mm-hmm. and being very, very concerned about the water that was in the road. It just is in my head that we made this deal with these guys to, you know, double up that one driveway to get into that fourth lot, and that was going to minimize water running down a driveway into the low spot where the water had a history of collecting. So why all of a sudden putting this new driveway in, would it make it the same?
Or
what's his drainage?
I should have sent you that.
So what the paragraph is saying, in my opinion, and this is coming from this engineers Pinkham and Greer, because of the excessively drained Colton soil underlying the site, these changes will cause no significant or measurable increase in the peak rate or volume of runoff leaving the ditch at the north corner of lot 4. I believe the conclusions of my original report, stormwater management at the 12th Street Acre Acton, Maine, dated October 16, 2014, are still valid. Well, apparently we didn't think they were valid in 2014.
Right. That's the same person that did the stormwater runoff then?
I think so.
Same person did it.
And what your recollection was that we amended his initial...
Well, part of the conditions of allowing the subdivision to go through was that they were going to, you know...
Common driveway.
The driveway was going to come in, it's going to come in here and then go across.
Yeah.
And that. Take care of that.
You want the developer come in next meeting?
Do you think that's... you tell me. I mean, we can make a decision. If we'd rather, as a group, wait, that's fine with me too. Makes no difference.
Ken, could we ask him to let us know what his sense of these site conditions would be when the soil is frozen?
I would think if it's the same engineer that had the same design earlier, so he would look at it both ways then. So it's the same engineer now saying it's no different than it was before. It is beautiful soils out there, but like you're saying, when it's frozen, it would have to be no snow on the ground, frozen.
Which is when we get a lot of heavy rain.
And that's when they were concerned about, you know, the slipping and sliding. Who's going to come in? Like, the show? Somebody from Ashcroft? Okay. I mean, that's fine. Unless you want to do it now, you tell me, everybody out there. What do you think?
Could we just run it? I mean, it wouldn't be too much for it to just have his engineer consider site conditions of frozen soil and make sure that his contention still holds up, I guess.
That's a question. Are they trying to amend the permit we already issued with conditions?
Correct.
Correct.
So we reviewed all this once.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
And now, like, it's the same engineer who's sending in another proposal.
They want to do make a change.
And now the abutters haven't changed their opinion, have they?
Well.
But they've already done it.
Yeah. They've already put that right there. That doesn't mean it's going to stay.
That's right, yeah. Exactly.
And I think I'm concerned to the abutters. We listened to them and we made the condition protecting them. How can we address ourselves?
That was that thing about that we were upset that we were not supposed to be listening to the abutters, but this was a case in point. I thought we...
Well, I thought the abutters do have a say-so when they come in.
And I guess they come in.
Yeah, they came in. They had a public hearing, yes.
So yeah. We can hang our hat on that.
Right. And the road association.
Has anyone come in and had called and complained about it?
The people that had concerns during the public hearings.
They have connected with you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh. I think
so they have to change their minds then.
No, but when I told them there was engineering saying it wasn't going to be any worse than without it, I haven't heard back from them.
Geez, what would we do in this situation? I feel like we should give them, like, we're going to have another discussion about it. It feels like they should be part of it. Like, what do? Do you have, like, a public hearing? Or?
What if we amend it and then they do get flooded out? And then the town would be liable for the flood.
I wouldn't think so. The engineer would be.
Or the engineer would be liable for it. But either way, you're still going to put those people in inconvenience by changing an ordinance, changing a conditional permit that they had already sort of, you know, backed off a little bit to allow it.
Mm-hmm. So the road's there, so we're still going to get runoff. Is this another deal where somebody decides, well, let's just put it in and then get slapped on the wrist and...
But sounds like
I get what I want.
I don't think he really fully read the plan at the time. Just assumed every lot had a driveway.
But he must have looked at the plans to see where the driveway was going to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, because, I mean, this letter from Stephen Stearns obviously mentions the revision. And this was back in... Mm-hmm.
Right, he's going to make a change. He should have come in before they did it.
So when would you suspect those driveways were put in? Summer?
Yeah.
Yeah. This letter is dated September 21st.
Correct, because I told them there was an issue out there. We needed to readdress it. So they had the surveying give us the as-built and a letter saying that it's no different to come back before you guys for a revised subdivision plan to consider.
I mean, I would be okay with them coming in next time and responding to Tom's question and answering any other questions that we might have at that point. I'd also be okay with making a decision, you know, tonight. It's all with what all you guys want to do.
My sense is he's already doing something that wasn't on the approved plan, so we kind of have to...
I'd say we deny it. Deny it,
give him the opportunity to come in and talk to us.
Yeah, before you go negative with that.
Let's make an assumption here for a second, not necessarily what's going to happen, I don't think, but let's say we deny it. Then all of a sudden we have a driveway that's in place. They would have to come back in and revegetate and do all of the same kinds of things that we run into when people do the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, go ahead and do something and then see what happens.
Yep.
Okay.
If you keep letting them get away with that by amending the situation, they're going to keep on abusing it.
All right, so let's set it up then, we'll have him come in. I don't hear much else besides that, you know, and then we'll make a decision after...
Can we dig up, just to refresh our memories too, dig up some of the discussions or that was had about...
We can get the minutes from the public hearing.
Okay.
We, I say we.
We?
Do you want those emails for you prior or just at the meeting?
Just at the meeting.
Could we also receive some update from Mr. Stearns as to conditions of frozen soil?
I would tell the developer that is the main concern, or a concern.
Just to make sure he took that into consideration in his analysis.
Yeah? Yep.
The main concern is he didn't do what he was supposed to do.
I'm thinking. All right, anything else?
Yeah, let's adjourn.
You have anything, kid? No, I don't think there's any other others out there.
No, there's no others.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
There you go.
Second?
You second this time.
All right, 5-0 for adjournment. All right.